Welcome to our final seminar this fall term, and I'm very pleased to introduce Hiroshi Ishii, who is a Jerome Wiesner professor at the Media Lab at MIT. We were just reminiscing. I first met Hiroshi in 1990 when I chaired a session at CSCW, and he was presenting one of his early pieces of work at that conference. So we've known each other for 25 years. And have interacted in many different forums and venues. I remember he hosted a visit by Judy and I to the NTT labs in Japan when he was there before moving first to Toronto and then to the MIT Media Lab, where he's been since the mid-90s. He's the director of the Tangible Bits Lab, which we'll hear more about, I'm sure. But what he's been doing more recently is looking at this new idea about radical atoms, sort of a step even beyond the tangible bits that he's worked on for many years. And so he's going to be telling us a story about this transition and illustrating it with lots of different innovative projects that he and his students have done over the years. So without further ado, I'm happy to introduce Hiroshi Ishii.
Thank you. Yes, sir. It's so nice to coming back to Yushi Airlines. Long ago, I came here because Jonathan Gruning was here. Also, Simon Penny invited me for some art event. But so nice to coming back here. Thanks to Judy and Gary also, and also many, many friends from CHI, CSCW, also media communities. Today, I have so much stuff I want to talk, but this is origin. Almost 25 years ago, I was in the field of CSCW, which Gary and Judy also really pioneered, basically how to support people who collaborate over distance or co-located. So this is one piece called Clear About. We really believe the seamlessness is very important. Often technology brings unnecessary seam, discontinuities. So this is an integration of interpersonal space like a Skype, video conference, and shared learning surface like a whiteboard. You can really see my gaze very precisely where I'm looking at because isotropic integrations of remote to physical space having a shared learning surface as an interface between digital space. This is already history, but today I'd like to talk about the theme of transdisciplinary. It's great to be in the UC Irvine, art department, design, architecture, materials, bio. Many people studying about a lot of interesting stuff, but also that foster cross-fertilization beyond discipline. So for me, transdisciplinary is finding opportunity in conflict between disciplines. And also breaking down old paradigms to create new archetypes. Today, I'd like to introduce a bunch of the examples of my effort to cross the boundaries. Let me start from art and sciences. So music and technology is one of very interesting, profound relationship. And one of my PhD candidates, Xiao Xiao, designs the mirror fugue. This is a bit like homage to Clear About. Now you see reflection of a pianist inside the piano. So now you see that the Xiao Xiao herself pre-recorded is inside the piano and ghost is playing. But also she can play with her own ghost. Well, ghosts can be also multiplied. Music not just vibration of air, but whole process of expression, even before her finger hits a key, music has already started. Her breathing, the motion of her shoulder, everything tells you about emotional expression. That's missing today of iPod, MP3, or streaming stuff. So we went to Milan. How many people went to Milan? It's an amazing city, but we had an opportunity to work with work at Milano Design Week, Milano Salone. Let me show the one of the latest piece called Transform, which is an example of radical atoms, which I'm going to talk later.
Another one is humans and motion, and also nature and machine.
So this is a new medium or materials we are working to communicate, express, also support design. And it's purely physical dynamic, but also perfectly digital. So this is a new entity which we call radical atoms. So this picture summarizes my battles against Pixel Empire in the past 20 years. When day one, before MIT, I did a lot of visual stuff, pixel stuff, like a creable team organization. But I was suggested by Nicholas to reboot. Don't continue anything I've done before in Japan. So he encouraged me to start from scratch. And he said, life is short. There's such a luxury to challenge new things. Then I love CSCW. I love remote collaboration. But I went to the origin of human-machine interaction, human-computer interaction. Then decided to study about the representation. How to represent information really matters. Today, everything's a pixel in TV, computer screen. It's intangible, stuck behind 2D screen. So it's incompatible with your body. You can't hug, you can't taste, you can't smell, you can't dance with these pixels. And so we decided to start tangible bits, tangible user interface, 20 years ago, give a physical embodiment. But recently, we hit another wall, so that we are making another jump called radical atoms. So I'd like to condense these 20 years of battles into 55 minutes. So for me, vision is something most important because that drives our research. This is a pyramid of technology, application needs, and the vision. The reason simply all the technology gets obsolete very quickly, even your amazing smartphone you love. That hardware model goes to landfill in 3 years. Then you buy a new iPhone or Android machine because obsolescence is embedded in the design of capitalism. Needs also constantly changing. We love music, but we don't use LP, CD, MP3 anymore. It's constantly changing. But the vision, like Barnaba, Bush, Memex, Douglas Engelbart, collective intelligence, or Ivan Sutherland, ultimate displays, never lose the energy or power. So there are certain things which have a much longer lifespan. Because I moved to academia so that I decided to enjoy this freedom. So physical and digital, how to bridge these two worlds is one of the common themes many people in HCL working. So we came up with the idea of tangible physical embodiment of digital information and computation. It's very abstract. Unless you really develop compelling serious application, nobody believes, nobody starts listening. It's a tough beginning, but I'd like to show one of the pieces which we did. So one of the key ideas, how to represent information. This representation really matters. So representation matters, and we started exploring how to represent the informations like oralis. So I'd like to show the examples of the artifact that I love a lot. That is this orali. How many people saw the orali in the museum? If you go to Historic Scientific Instruments Museum, you see a bunch of the beautiful physical artifacts which are abundant. So in a way, being replaced by pixel. But this has amazing, beautiful capabilities. For example, so basically representation really matters. But this orally has very important engine so that you can really grab these handles. These handles are compatible with your hand, with the body. Once you grab, and once you start to rotate, your body, your muscle, your bone, your neural system is a part of the machine. There's no ambiguity about the causality chain. Why planets circle around the sun? Why four seasons exist? This clarity, this engagement is missing in current pixel because so abstract and intangible and decontextualized. Also, that's naturally support co-located collaborations so teachers and the students can explore all the knowledge. So we are very much interested about how to really capture this idea to embody that the digital information so that we can really give a physical substance, bring information computation much closer to the body. Let me show the one classic example called the bottles. Mm-hmm. like coffee bottles or genie bottles. The musicians or music inside the bottles, once you open, that's coming out like a perfume. It's a very simple minimal design to just play and mute. But the glass bottles has own emotional aesthetic pleasures. It's also fragile. Once you drop, you can't reboot it. Same as life. The reason I started this project is a very personal one. I had a dream to give a gift present to my mom, who lives in Sapporo City, north part of Japan. When she wakes up, she wants to check the weather of the day. And she has to wait in front of TV at the 7 a.m. news. But instead, I want her to open these blue bottles, which contain the weather forecast. So today's fine day. She cooked for me opening soy sauce bottles 1,000 times. So she knows opening the smell coming out. That's a word. She never touched any machine in her life. But she passed away in 1998. So I designed this one as a tribute to my mom. But also, my very important friend and the gurus, Mark Weiser, passed away the year after. So that became a tribute to her stuff. So always kind of a one of the driving force of the design is not the utility or usability testing, but often that comes from the sense of the loss of the important people like Mark Weiser. So that made me to do the project. Because he talked about ubiquitous computing, that all the technology disappear, become transparent. So this also the one of the expression of his vision of transparent UI. So we wrote a paper as a tribute to Mark Weiser. So let me show the totally different kind of stuff. How many people paint water or oil? Oh, that's good. So this is a piece to bring back the practice of the Renaissance era paintings. Because Renaissance era painters were also the color makers. They made their own pigments rather than use given ink. They went to the field to collecting sand, rocks, soil, or plants or flowers to create exact the color that you want to express. So world is full of the beautiful color and the texture waiting for you to be discovered and be used. So we are very much interested in how to utilize those amazing beauty of the world as a new materials for the expression.
S'il vous plaît.
This is a work by Kiriko Ryokai, and she's now tenured professor of University of Berkeley, which I'm so excited. But even the color of the dog is not just dry number, not dry RGB number, all the emotional attachment and the story behind it. So that every stroke or drawing has a meaning. You can embed, weave all these stories into the every stroke of the painting.
S'il vous plaît.
If you go to Whole Foods markets, you may buy and eat beautiful foods. But the combination of the beautiful color, already color rings in New Hampshire, may inspire you, but also encourage you to create a new art piece. So key idea behind of the chemical thesis work as a palette. After experiencing, interacting with eye brush, people start to see the world as a palette, inviting you to express the beauty using raw materials from the world. But this is not just a painting. Painting is dead ink stuck on the 2D surface. But if you see, you can see the new dimension, Z-axis. You see teddy bear, from which color came from. Now you can capture all the origin, source of the information in the final painting. So we brought this to the kindergartens, but the beauty, she never listened to MIT professor. She just came up her own interpretation.
Yeah.
So this is the best moment as an interaction designer because she went far better than us, went beyond imaginations. Because it's not a box, it's just opportunity. There's no ceiling. Floor is low because it looks like a paintbrush, but it's not necessary to be used as a painting. You can become a whatever. So this is a picture I took in Barcelona when I went to the Art Future Conference 2005, and see the whole market is a beautiful palette. So interesting future, kids traveling all around the world, what kind of painting they may create using a technology. We also like a lot of the artistic expression. This is an audio by James Patten and Ben Lett did it. And this inspired, they gave a presentation in NIME conference in Barcelona. Then the team in Barcelona took this idea to the next React table, which was used by many professional musicians. How many people do computer music, reality music? Great. The computer music is great, but the performance is not necessarily very intuitive because motion of the body and instrument resulting sound, totality is not clear. So we try to make a new grammar, graphical representation, bimanual interaction, multi-user, so the how to communicate the process of computational music performance. That is the project we did. Also, I like ping pong. How many people play ping pong? Seriously. Okay, I'm not serious about ping pong and research, but anyway, this is a ping pong table we did also many, many years ago, attaching four microphones, listening to the ball hit, doing a triangular, blah, blah, blah. But anyway, you can change the competitiveness of zero-sum game, bit like a life of untenured professor, but you can change, even if you can make a mistake. Ball make a nice water ripple, all the audience enjoy. We try to make like a new social media, compete against Facebook. Anyway, you can program all the behavior of the table. So that's interesting stuff. So we also made an open source version, remade it using Arduino and also processing. And this is a party when my kids from my my girls' kindergarten came. So most beautiful girl is my daughter. If you point, who is the most beautiful daughter? I can invite you. Anyway, so this is my new lab. So we are fortunate, a part of the media was part of school of architecture planning. And architecture planning has a very, very rich vocabulary culture, talking about the concept, technology, science, and also the implication for the society or community. So this is one of the early work that John DeCoffra, Dr. John DeCoffra did for his PhD thesis. All this building is tangible, but the shadow you see is computational shadows. So physical building casts computer shadow. Then you can use the clock as an inverse clock as a means to control the day of time so that you can really explore the inter-shadow problems in the buildings. Also, you can simulate the window simulation, like a Navier-Stokes equation. Most important thing, you can do everything in computer using GUI. But once you have a physical stuff, it's so easy, also democratic. Everybody can move the building to see the consequence. But if you show this video, you can't trust me because I might already biased. I want to sell real estate, so optimize. But you can really test a lot of the hypotheses. So this underlying simulation and tangible interface, which serve simultaneously multi-user, is something very interesting. But this is almost 20 years old piece, but this is the origin of tangibles. After this project, finally people start listening, oh, there's something interesting. And eliminating clay and soundscape is another jump, because without any tag, without any identity, how to really make sense the interaction with the materials, in this case sound, but this is for landscape design. So landscape designer try to give a beautiful, aesthetically pleasing landscape, but simultaneously they have to pay attention about water drainage or how much photons each plant or trees can get so that they can survive. So do all the form giving for beauty of right side of brain and the left side of analysis you can use using the same materials, in this case sand or clay. However, unfortunately these materials shy, inert, frozen, you can change the shape manually, but it doesn't remember the shape which took before. So that's the reason we decided to go to the next levels. How to bring kinetic memory, memory of shape, memory of interaction, dynamically change the shape. That's the radical atoms that we started explore. Today, how many people are designers? How many people are artists? Oh, I know the people who raise the hand twice. So anyway, you guys have two materials option to use. One is frozen atoms, these wood, glass, it's frozen, there's no computational guts, consciousness. Second, computational but completely intangible pixels stuck behind a 2D screen. And so my dream is to make a new kind of the materials which fully physical, dynamic, but computational. That we call radical atoms. It's very hypothetical, but the three capabilities, transformable, conformable, also informable. So this is an early prototype to using a shapeless relief. Daniel Reitzinger designed this one for his master thesis. Rendering used to be the computer graphics pixel on the screen, but now you can see physical structure also corresponds to the computational models, and vice versa. Also, if you change computational model, physical model change. Also, if you manipulate physical models, you can also go through the history, like erosion of the mountains or mountain building. You are not traveling the time, direct manipulation. Also, indirect mid-air gesture you can command. So we are inventing new representation of information and a new interaction with those new materials. That is a relief. Then we went to the next level called inform, adding more pins, almost 1,000 pins. So this is a piece called inform. How many people saw this video? Okay. So this is a big kind of homage to old work of CSCW or telepresence, because we did a lot of the video mediated stuff, also many great work about the group pair, collaboration. But I was really interested about how to really re-embody your body over distance, but not using robots or not using audio visuals. So this is a way that you can capture, then transmit, then physically embody your body. But your body is physical, so that you can really manipulate objects, materials. So that's a new dimension. And also you can use any found object, like buckets, so that you can, so means you can also alter the hand. Now my hand is this, but you can change the shape of the hand in any way, bit like a Strax art of third arms. So we are very excited about alter your body if necessary. And you know, you can do all sorts of the crazy stuff, but the most interesting stuff is people really care about telepresence, the body. Once body is physically embodied, people get so excited. Also, we have many different applications. Oh, this is important, intermaterial interaction. So this is called shape display, but best misleading. Shape display both means eyes, photons. But this is a machine, robots, actuators. So this actuation implies something very radically new. And so you can move anything on this planet. And also the affordance, notion of affordance starts falling apart, because affordance was argued basically relatively still, some freedom of the movement, like a doorknob, but not computationally dynamically, completely dynamically reconfigured materials. Then how to communicate, how to inform the affordance limitation is something very interesting kind of the questions. So we rebuilt this one based on the commission of the Cooper Hewitt Design Museum in New York. Did anybody go to New York? Oh, great, thank you. It's a great pleasure. Now it's returned to my lab, kind of half broken, but we are trying to repair. But now you can see all the red balls being manipulated. So I think the most important thing, this is not practical. Resolution is very low, very flaky. But knowing that is possible, you can re-embody anything you scan into the body over distance. Open the door to a lot of interesting interaction. So we went to the next project called Transform. And Transform is based on the three engine of inform, you just saw it. So putting them together based on the metaphor of triptych. I love triptych and the paintings. So we made a kinetic triptych using the three engines. So we exhibit in the Milan Salones for a week. And a bunch of the people came, and many people gave nice comments, like amazing. Because message we have to send is amazing emotion, so it's nice light comments. So let me show the videos which show the story we talked in Milan. So one of the theme is nature versus machine. And this represents nature, water, a wave. This is a fish, school of the fish. So now you can energize the water leakage. Then machine wakes up. So machine is jealous about nature because so beautiful. So machine try to emulate, copy the aesthetics of the wave, direct motion of the wave, computationally or mathematically. So you can imagine mathematical equation, parametric design under the water. Jealous about human beings because they can socialize, they can dance, they can tweet, they can Facebook. But they found the friends, it's frozen atoms, red balls. So now they are dancing with old materials, frozen atoms, red balls. But it's a story of the ancient civilizations near the seashore. Or BC 7000, there was an empire, kingdom, and a big city. They made a big castle. But this empire didn't last long. They started declining, then submerged under the waters, like Atlantis. So this is a story we taught in Milan, asking artist or designer, this is one of the millions of the stories you can tell. What kind of story you want to tell, you can tell. So this is like a, for me, birth of the white canvas, paintbrush, ink, waiting for the Gogh, Picasso, or Matisse. Would you like to be Matisse? So that's kind of an invitation that we sent to the most creative peoples who was in the Milan Design Week. So always the collision of the concepts really helps us to shape the idea. So intriguing elegance through careful juxtaposition of opposing elements. That's a design philosophy called Elfiness by Lexus. Lexus was a collaborator, also sponsor of this project. How to really pursue this aesthetics? We juxtapose design versus technology. Also stillness and motion. And atoms and the bits. Always collision of those concepts really gives a new opportunities to explore new things. So after this project, many people ask, so what? Who cares? So we made a new students made a project of the hypothetical story, how the future environment, like the furniture, may change. Then what kind of the interesting things may happen? This is all the prescripted scenario that my students and the machine are playing. So it's not truly interactive. But you can imagine, this is an envisionment, like a video with a blue screen. But now you can see that using all the context awareness, situated intelligence, you can really make environment transform to accommodate the needs. We don't do the gamble, but for the sake of the demonstration, student did it. So now you can think about all the interesting future. Because we live in the world of the frozen atoms and the internet pixel, it's very difficult to think about beyond that. But once you know that's feasible, then what makes sense is a good question. For me, perfect heavenly bed. Because the all the force feedback working, every pin being pressed down can sense the pressure. Then also push back, so that you can really cancel all the friction of the bed or pillow. So there are a lot of interesting possibilities that you can explore. So we have a limitation of the user-centered design because no user, no technology, no task when you came up idea. But still you can envision, then communicate with the people. So that's something I care, but very difficult for certain academic community. But nice, design people are people like those kind of stuff. So radical design doesn't stop at the shape display, but also we do a lot of the bio-inspired, bio-mimicking materials, which all we call programmable materials. So this is a chart shows us two big streams. Top is shape display, like inform transform. Bottom is a program materials. So I'd like to quickly show the three types of program materials. First of all, MUI. This was presented in WISP and got the best paper, but let's play. So basically, we program the structural transformation into the materials using a special printing technique or fabrication technique by combining elastic and non-elastic materials. If you know what kind of transformation you want to see happen, then you can really manufacture, fabricate. But no 3D printer to make this kind of stuff. It requires a lot of the complicated stuff, but also combining sensing. Now you see sensing and transformation. Now this shadow is changing the height of the building. So you see this homage to the app. But also you can also express all the textural change, transformations. So you can really communicate very subtle tactile signals. We are now enriching the boundaries of the communications. So this is another material called jam sheet. You can change the stiffness. Imagine you have a yoga mat. Usually it's soft, but you can change the stiffness in several seconds, sucking the air, so that you can really conform, deform, then you can sit. So now this room has a nice carpet. Imagine the carpet and all the curtains connected together. You can just download 3D form, then shape the chair. Then you can partially soften, then adjust. So it's a totally different way to create furniture on the fly in the conference room. Also, we work with New Balance because stiffness of the shoes have to change dynamically, especially if you do ski. How many people do ski? So you know all the shape. It's so awkward to go to lunch after ski. Anyway, so you can do a lot of the adjustment. So one of the highlights is the biologic, which I really want to talk today. This is the first time public talk to introduce this biologic in the context, introducing two videos. So bio is a new digital, is a message that Nicolas Negroponte said, I think this year. And he doesn't remember, but anyway, he said. And so there are a lot of the research, Joe Jacobs, Ed Boydens, Larry Oxmans, and but bio become a new kind of the medium to think with, design with. So we came up with a vision, bio is a new interface. Our take is, we came from a HCI, human-computer interaction, or a human-machine interface. But the human-living machine interface, living machine is a bacteria, interface with environment, is the next jump we are very much interested in. So let me show the video clip of Sherwin of the biologic. Thank you. fermented foods in Japan, and they grow from 1 cell to 10 billion overnight. So we found the very interesting capability to change the size based on relative humidities. So that becomes a sensor and actuators driven by the relative humidity change, also temperature. So based on this discovery, we developed a printing system and the software to print this solution of the Bacillus subtilisator bacteria in a form to make a desirable transformation as a second skin of a human being who dance, or who run, or who sweat. So we collaborated with a dancer of the Boston Ballet Company to test this idea in a real stage. Importance is physiology. We have a science of the physiology about sweat map and heat map. Those models, computational models, inform to the design. So measuring all the transformations scientifically, then making a software tools help us design desirable functionalities. I'm not a bioscientist, but the MIT campus is an amazing biological expert who offered help. Also the computational architecture design student from architecture department. Many people came, but knowing we are doing some crazy stuff. Then we discuss, and so I really appreciate. Also you guys in the universities, UC Irvine have an amazing department and talented people. Also today on campus, Don Norman is giving lectures in another like event. So hope you really take advantage of being at amazing universities. So bio is a new interface, is one of the important statement, because now we are now thinking more like a skin for interstellar astronauts who travel with a spaceship. But spaceship itself, architecture itself, because not a skin to the outer environment. So if you really think about living machine as an interface, that's extremely interesting. So we now started the exhibition in my lab to showing about how this works. So we did an installation October 28th, because October 30th, we had a 30th anniversary of MIT Media. To celebrate this event, we started the exploration of the exhibit, how to communicate the bio is a new interface to the rest of the world. We have a materials which nature produced, material which was born from nature, versus materials we made, we designed. This is material we made with the help of the natural bacteria printed. You see all the geometries. So they transform as we expect, because we compute, then print. This is a Mother Nature produce. This is a bacteria growing in a shell. So this is a representation of the body having a biology as a skin. It responds to the humidity. The machine, both sides, is a steamboat. One steam emitted. Now you see the dancers performing in the lab. this is biologic. And there are a lot of interesting message, but maybe one thing is so important is I trained as engineers, computer engineers, but my knowledge of System 3 or Unix Berkeley version 4.2 or obsolete. But there are new digitals, in this case bio, is coming. So it's really interesting to think about what we can do, which I couldn't do before. We build, having a clear goal, component, system, precision, but the totally different paradigms to let it grow, heal, or die. Totally different engine. They complement each other. So man-made, building, engineering, but nature delight to let it grow, heal. That's also very, very interesting potentials to explore, especially new technology of the synthetic biology became so available, CRISPR technology. And so you can really hack the gene, make a desirable new like bacteria, inheriting a different property from different bacteria, which now we are working on. To summarize, transdisciplinary is something very important driving force, but finding opportunity in conflict between disciplines, also deconstruct the old paradigm to create new archetype, and transform beyond preconceived concept. That's something we are very passionate, and we'd like to continue to do that. So, as a message, because I really enjoy the lunch with many enthusiastic, energetic students. Who was in lunch with me? Good. And so I think for me, gaining the new perspective, something is so important, you can learn in the school. People observed the stars using naked eye many years ago, but they invented a telescope, but still bound to the earth and the head. And also they invented all the observatory, but still on the mountains, stuck on the earth. But the important jump happened when NASA deployed Hubble Space Telescope. Then this is like a detaching your eyes from your head and throw into the space, then look back yourself. That's the important thing, you can do it. So you have to be stop being engineer or designer or artist. You have to be explorer, creator, to endeavor to new territories. And Voyager is another great example, which I love a lot. But the most important thing is people could only see the world from their own perspective. You get stuck. If you print, I'm a manager or engineer, it's a dead end. You can be anybody. You can do anything. So don't constrain yourself, but broaden your perspective is so important. Enhance, expand, also even escape with comfort zone is something very, very important. So gaining holistic perspective, dynamic tidal change, like bio is a new digital, is something very important. But also problems, so many interesting stuff. You are distracted. You really have a heuristic focus, what you focus. So I focus on natto bacteria, as an example today. So I'd like to restate that the finding opportunity in conflict between disciplines is so important. If you're happy, peaceful, comfortable, it might be dead end. You have to be uncomfortable. Right levels of uncomfortableness is something very important. Then you have to break down all the paradigms. You don't need to really follow. You don't need to get stuck with the old scheme, you're the archetype. And so I hope you really have an exciting endeavor. And Alan Kay, who headhunted me 21 years ago in Atlanta, said, future is not to predict, but to invent. This is a very important statement. It may sound a bit arrogant, but you have to have a real belief. I create, I prototype the future. Then I excite you. I want you to resonate. Then you may choose as a mainstream. So you have to be at the fringe. You shouldn't be mainstream at the beginning. And your paper should get rejected fast. So I think vision is something very, very important to driving my research. But the most important thing, you have to really dream up what kind of future you want to create and what kind of world you want to give to your descendants. But to do so, you have to embody your vision. Vision is often very abstract. You have to really materialize in a way people can experience, digest, understand. That's my music bottles, or inform, transform, or biologic. But each project is not a goal. Most important thing is meta message. Also, your work has to inspire people. Otherwise, people don't care. People forget. Or another nice IoT, Internet of Things, which disappear very, very quickly. So I think to envision art and the philosophy is the most important driving force. But also inspire people. You have to come back to the attitude of the art. Art is so important. So I think, hope you take art seriously. I wish Simon Penny is in the audience, but anyway, I just want to say. So I'd like to thank this opportunity today that I was invited to UCLA. It's a great pleasure to meet you. And thanks to Judy and Gary also, and the many people who helped this event. And I have a plan to go to different places relatively soon. One of my students said, maybe opposite direction, but anyway, I'm gone. But the most important thing is all together, all gone in 2100. And the reason I talk, this one is our life may end, but the future never end. 2200, still people living on this planet. So the question I ask myself, my students, my colleagues, what do you want to pass on to those living in 2200? How do you want to be remembered? And what do you want your legacy to be? So that's a very profound question. Asking this question seriously, you can't waste any second. You can't really work hard with a goal. So 2200 is not a simple number, but a message about the future. Because life has set end point, but the future is never ending. And we love technology, but all the technology soon become obsolete. But the true vision is everlasting. Okay, thank you very much for your kind attention. Yeah.